What's up, everybody? 915 Mang here, joining a video today on Kevin's mixed 125-gallon reef tank. Now, the thing that makes this tank so unique is the fact that he is not dosing anything, okay? He's not dosing. He's not running a protein skimmer. He is solely relying on some simple filtration, and we're going to get to hang out with Kevin, and he's going to tell us all about it. The cool thing about Kevin is that he knows his stuff about fish. He'll help you out. He also has a YouTube, but for now, let's go ahead and take a look at his saltwater side, and then we'll take a look at his freshwater side later on. So there's the Monty. So that third anemone is on the back?
It's right below the big one. The first one you can see.
Oh, okay, I see
it. It's tiny.
Oh, I see it. Good thing it's next to some Xenia, but it doesn't kill Xenia for whatever reason.
Man, I wish I could raise the lights like that. That would be so much better.
What do you mean?
If I could raise them up? Raise them.
And sit and get rid of this canopy or what?
Yeah.
I actually got the AI rails. I mean, I don't know if you would want it.
I just have to take the lid off.
Hey.
Playing Pokemon.
And you haven't got any new corals?
No, nothing new actually. I just kind of let it go, letting it grow in and just kind of leaving it alone. I mean, in the past, my other couple of reefs, I always buy new stuff and
put stuff
everywhere. And I just figured I want to see what it, I mean, that's about, probably about $1,300 worth of coral in there. So I figured I'd just let it all grow out and fill in and just see what happens.
I know it's been a while. And still no skimmer, right?
No skimmer.
And how come you don't wanna get a skimmer?
Well, I mean, I've used skimmers before. I had one. I had a Reef Octopus and also had a Deltec when I lived in Pensacola. And I always have to externally hook them up.
Oh, okay.
Because I'd rather have a huge refugium, because the refugium, it really does feed the tank. You don't have to go out and buy expensive coral foods and different stuff. You know, your main additives, like if you want to put in iodine every once in a while, that's good. But with the reef salts that I use, a water change every week, so that replenishes all of that stuff by doing those multiple water changes. So that kind of counteracts the need to buy calcium and alkalinity and all the different things that you normally put into your tank. The pre-made marine salt mixes actually have all that stuff in the pack. So as far as the skimmer goes, the water changes are essentially doing the same thing that a skimmer does, as long as you're doing them every week, and you're doing a lot, like, you're not going to be able to take out a lot of dissolved organics with a 10% water change. Scientifically, that doesn't make any sense.
Right.
But if you're doing, 30 gallons to 60 gallons, like I do anywhere between 20 and 30 a week, and then every, like, I think about 4 months, 5 months, I'll take some bacteria, some organic waste cleaner, and I'll pour it in the tank. And I'll let it get the, just completely just clean out the tank. And once that happens, I do a 60 to 70% water change, and that makes the water pure, you know? So it's just a different method. But I think that there's nothing wrong with skimmers. I don't have anything against them at all. But people in the 80s, and you know, when people first started keeping marine tanks, they didn't have skimmers. They didn't use stuff like that. I've been running this tank now, what is it, like month 14 now? Almost month 15? And I haven't lost anything. The only thing that I lost was, I lost a colony of tamers, and I lost,
this is a bulb, huh?
Huh?
This is a bulb, huh?
It's a what?
A bulb? The refugium light?
No, it's just a regular inline LED, marine land LED, low watt, made for freshwater tanks. I mean, Calerpa doesn't need that much light to grow. It's going to grow.
So, but you do have to keep your light on 24/7, right?
Yeah, that light stays on every day, all day long. I never turn it off.
Is it true if you turn it off that it'll grow into the display of your tank? Or
the Calerpa, no. Anyways? What will happen from it going into the display of your tank is if pieces of it fall off over the rim right there, and they actually get sucked into the return pump.
Okay.
And then it makes its way into the display, and then if it attaches itself to a rock, then it begins to grow. But when you have tanks in your tank, it's not going to grow. If you feed tanks seaweed, and you feed them, you know, red seaweed, the green seaweed, that tastes better to them. They like the taste of it. And what will happen is, if you get that in your tank, they won't prefer to eat that over the seaweed. So they get trained, it's just like a dog, they get accustomed to a certain type of food, and if that food tastes better, they would rather have that. So I don't feed them any seaweed, but what I do is, to keep them from getting head and lateral line disease and them losing their health, I feed them marine pellets, vegetable pellets. So I buy only vegetable pellets, and then I feed them New Life Spectrum. So I only use pellets in the tank.
Okay.
Or I use flake food for the chromises. The chromies, you know, they have to eat a lot because their metabolisms are so high.
Really?
Yeah, that's why a lot of people, when they start out with 12 chromies and they only end up with 3, it's because they're not meeting their food needs. So I have 7 in there. That's how many I started out with about a year ago. I haven't lost a single one of them. And every day I feed, in the morning, I feed the New Life Spectrum and the vegetable pellets. And then at night, I'll go through with New Life Spectrum flake food. And the flake food, it sits up on the top, so it doesn't really go to the bottom as much. And that gives them enough time to eat a whole lot of the food. They get to eat, you know, more than they normally would if you just drop, like, frozen cubes or whatnot. Because the other fish attack that stuff.
Yes.
So they're more top feeders, you know. If you get it up on the top, they're going to eat it a lot faster than everybody else. So I just have like a routine. I keep everybody on a routine.
Cause with the whole chromies, you know, I've talked about it. I think I was saying that they kill each other. You think they
do? They will kill each other. If you add chromises to an already established group,
okay.
They form a hierarchy. You know, they form a small hierarchy within each other, and then if you put other ones in there, It's like somebody invading their territory.
Mm-hmm.
It's another group, and they're competing for food and for real estate, you know, for a place to live. They live in Acroporas in the wild. So if like a rival group comes up, they fight. So that's the same thing in a tank. If you have a group of chromises in your tank that's already formed that hierarchy, then they're going to wipe out all of the new ones that you put in. It may take a month, it may take 2 months, but they're not part of that group. That's what I've found, because I've tried adding chromises later on during the thing. Also, you can see who the members of the top apex are in the group by which ones are fatter, which ones are bigger, and the more less dominant ones are always going to be a lot smaller, a lot thinner, and that's why you want to feed them, you know, a lot of food. They need a lot of food, especially for the ones that aren't getting as much, because I've watched their behavior. When I feed them, the bigger ones, they'll chase them away, and try to keep them from getting to the food.
There you go, guys. I didn't know all that. And I know in one of your videos you were talking about changing out the mud. Did you do that?
No, I haven't changed out the mud at this point. I really haven't seen any decline in anything. Everything's still growing real well. Also, I didn't really follow the directions of the Miracle Mud itself. I used, I got some Refugium Mud Booster in like a pint. And then I mix that into the sand on the bottom layer, and it states on that product that it never has to be changed out as often. You just have to add the booster in there. And I really wish that that Miracle Mud would come out with that, because to do that Refugium, man, it's like $130 for all that Miracle Mud. It was expensive, and that's why I gave it a 9 out of 10 on the reviews. For the cost, but for the 9, I mean, if you look at the corals and you look at those fish, I mean, those fish are really, 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 really colorful.
Yeah, your freaking yellow tang is huge.
They're real healthy, and I've had a couple of reef tanks.
Well, you know what you're doing, because your corals do look good. That's the thing, that you got people talking, you know, about reefs and all that, but they, you know, they don't have anything to show it or back it up. And your tank for sure is thriving. The color, the clothes. This is a trip, because all of these started off as little tiny frags, and then here they are, like full-blown colonies. Especially this. This was just a little tiny piece on a frag. Looks cool.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I could do that, absolutely.
Cut them for $50.
$50?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's cool. So, any other changes, plans for this tank?
Okay, so... what I attribute to the success of this tank mainly is the lack of change. Like, I don't do really anything differently. I don't move the corals. I don't try to move them unless there's like an emergency. The last time I moved them was just because this hammer right here was attacking these Duncans. All right, and these Duncans right here were almost dead when, you know, a few weeks ago. All the polyps were gone. They fell down into the sand bed from a blenny for about a week before I noticed them, because I really don't have to take care of this tank but like once a week. But I think the key, to you know, being able to be successful, even with the protein skimmer, is stability. I don't change my lights. A lot of reefers, you want to go and get
the newest lights, change your lights because you don't think something's working. You change this, you change that. And I don't think the corals like that. I think that they like, once you set them up, and as long as you have a full spectrum light and you're using, you know, a certain method, I think you should stick to that method. Do not change it and just let it be stable. Also, like overdosing chemicals. A lot of people like to go crazy with chemicals. Everybody wants to immediately get coralline algae.
Yep.
And they wanted to get the results as fast as they can. Well, this tank didn't start out like this, and a lot of the corals in here, as a matter of fact, I'll take this torch and for instance. When I got this torch right here, it was 3 heads when I got it. And when I put it in there, 2 of the heads shrunk in and they died immediately because I had just put them in the tank, and about a week later, they were all sucking in. And what I had done was I put iodine in the tank, and I dosed my tank and put a few additives in my tank when I was dosing this tank. And then I stopped all of that. I just put miracle mud in my tank. I did a water change about 30%, 20% every Sunday, and I did nothing. Absolutely nothing. I just let the lights do the work, and I only fed my fish. I didn't feed the corals any food. I don't feed them anything because, you know, a lot of these companies.
It's a big right there. Yeah, so it's not little.
No, that's a head right there. That's a head right there. That's a head right there, and that's a head right there. I have 4 heads of that now. And coming back from only having 1 because they died. But the main thing that the main advice that I would give people is just stability, the water parameters, everything. And let's face it, if you're doing a water change every single week, you know, with 20 to 30 gallons of water, you're replenishing all the trace elements. Not all the trace elements. I do add trace elements, like a little spoonful to the water, because I use RO water. So the main thing is I'm using RO water, and whatever's in that salt mix is replenishing the magnesium and everything. I don't monitor my levels. I don't do tests. I don't do anything. I just look at my tank. And if I see that, I can either tell that something's molting. Like I did a video a couple weeks ago on this leather right here. And this leather was molting, and now it's shedding off a frag. Mm-hmm. So that little frag's coming off right there. And this one right here is closed up. And
is it the same kind of leather, or is it like this one?
That's the same exact leather. And I know what's pissing this leather off too. I know why it's angry. It's not molting, because it would have a brown film and stuff over it. The reason why this one's closed up is because right now in my sump, the water level is too low, which means the salinity is raised. Mm-hmm. And these corals are used to being at a certain salinity, at a certain temperature. They're all used to being the food coming into the water at the same time of the day, the lights coming on at the same time of the day. I don't change it's just stability. Along with that, and talking about miracle mud, if you were to get miracle mud, you were to put it in your tank. Miracle mud has a whole bunch of different nutrients and different additives, like magnesium. It has nickel. It has all kinds of metals and different things that are good, that are actually good for the corals. So what that means is there's no more having to dose your tank with all this different stuff. I mean, if you want to add in alkalinity to try to make if you have SPS in your tank, then we're talking a different ball game. It's a different story. I mean, you have to add alkalinity. You have to keep your calcium above 440 parts per million in order for your calcium for your hard corals to thrive, because they need that to build their skeletons. But along with that, the LPS need it too, because they have skeletons too.
Yeah,
that they use calcium to build them with. So that's my purpose for the water change every single week, because that's replenishing the calcium. So, I mean, call it what you will. Some people may say, oh, it's expensive to buy salt, and it's cheaper to buy a protein skimmer. Well, I mean, I've eliminated having to buy chemicals, additives, all kinds of stuff, and along with that, buying a protein skimmer. And my living room's a lot quieter.
Yes.
You asked me earlier why I don't like using a skimmer. Because the damn things are noisy.
Mm-hmm.
They make a lot of noise, you know? I mean, there's some of them out there are really, really expensive, and they're a little bit quieter than some of them, but it's still, it's added noise in the living room, and this is where I spend most of my time. So my goal is just to try to make this tank as quiet as possible.
So you're talking about the miracle mud and the... No, we're talking about the plans, the future plans of the coral growth or adding more coral.
Well, I mean, what I want to happen is, I want basically the depth of the aquarium. You know, a lot of the corals are up on the front,
mm-hmm.
and to give it a better dimension, I need to start planting some corals in the back and back up on the ledges and let them grow up. So that it gives it kind of more of a 3D dimension. It's already kind of got a 3D dimension to it.
Yeah, because your tank is pretty deep.
Yeah.
How deep is this, a 20 inch?
This is just a standard 125.
But it looks about
I think
bigger
it's 20.
Than, yeah.
I think it's 20 high.
Yeah. Yeah, I see what you're talking about, because you still got a whole bunch of room right here.
Yeah, I got an anemone back here, a little carpet anemone, a mini maxi. It houses a sexy shrimp I got. Probably about 14 or 15 of those running around the tank somewhere. A lot of them have migrated over to the bubble anemones. They're living around it, or sometimes they're in them. But during the day, they're kind of nocturnal. They don't really come out until evening time. During the day, I think they hide. Which is kind of weird, you know. In the wild, I would think that at nighttime most of the fish and the invertebrates hide, and then during the day they're out. But
really,
oh, here
cool.
goes one right here going crazy.
Oh, there we go.
He's to the right of the. There he goes, right there. Yeah, but I have about 13 or 14 of those guys. I started off with like 6, and then I ordered like 8 or 9 more.
Yeah, they are cool.
Yeah.
Alright, so I guess we'll just end this video here. And thanks for having us over, and we'll check out your freshwater tanks.
Absolutely, no problem.